Okay, then welcome and thanks for joining our presentation. We will talk, thanks for the introduction, we will talk about how Qt Quick Applications can be used inside BRED. Short introduction, who we are. So my name is Pascal Seifert, I'm the technical product manager of BRED, which is a visualization software, and I'm responsible for executing the roadmap and make what is high level into actually features with our development and XD team together. And with me is my awesome colleague, Markus.
Need to go to the microphone. Yeah, my name is Markus. I'm a software developer at Autodesk and I'm working on BRED. And yeah, I will talk a bit about the technical parts of the presentation.
So a short introduction, what is Autodesk? So Autodesk is a software company that was founded in 1982. Our headquarter is in the US in San Rafael, and most people know Autodesk from AutoCAD, which is I think still our most successful and most selling software. Even yesterday at the party, someone asked me and said, "Hey, you're working for AutoCAD?" And I know the Autodesk. That's a little bit something different. But today, our portfolio contains more than 140 products in different areas. So one main area Autodesk is working in is the architecture and engineering and construction space, so everything that has to do with buildings and cities and infrastructure inside that. Then a huge area is also the media entertainment business, so if some people know Maya, 3ds Max, so everything that has to do with science fiction, 3D modeling, gaming, creating content. And the third area is product design and manufacturing, and this is actually where we both are in and working in. In a smaller department inside that, which is the automotive, which is Autodesk Automotive. So, therefore, I'd like to show you a little video what we are actually doing. Unfortunately, it's not working in full screen. So yeah, everything you have seen in that video is somehow at some point in time created with Autodesk tools. So we as an automotive group inside Autodesk try to provide our customers with tools that help them to realize their ideas and their products from the early beginning, from the very sketch on a paper to the final product at the end. And you have seen tools for sketching to get the first ideas, creating shapes and surfaces inside VR in a 3D virtual reality space. We have tools for rapid prototyping, conceptual design, so when from the first idea, the first 3D model is created. So Alias, for example, is one big tool in our portfolio. We also have tools for prototyping, like PowerMill, where you can create models for the CNC milling machines. We also have tools that help to visualize these first ideas, to experience your ideas or your 3D models, play around with it, get some impressions of the first user experience in an immersive review where you can check variants, different material variations to the final review with the board members or with the end customer at the very end. And the backbone behind all these tools is another tool we are using, which is Shotgun, which is a data management pipeline, so that you, during the process, can store your data and reuse it at any time. So these are the main products we are working on as an automotive group. But in this talk, we will focus on a software that is called VRED, Virtual Reality Editor. And in that case, we explain a little bit about more the user experience and the immersive design reviews that can be done with VRED. So as I said, VRED means Virtual Reality Editor. And basically, it's a real-time visualization tool that helps designers or anyone who's in context with automotive content to help to visualize their ideas. So you can import your CAD data. We support, I think, more than 40 different native CAD formats. You can bring in your data. You can enrich your data with materials, with interactions, with different environments, with variations, with animations. So whatever makes the content looking good and sexy, you can use VRED for this. And this until you get the final content or the final image or the final animation out of that. So this is, and there's also a video, this is where we're coming from. So virtual reality editors, so real-time visualization is our history. So these images are kind of old. So this is not what you see outside in the booth with the Oculus Rift and the new modern headsets. This is more engineering driven and engineering setups. Also the content is very engineering heavy, as you can see on the lower left image. So this is actually the data our customers visualize and experience in virtual reality. But with the hybrid approach we have in VRED, it is also possible to do ray tracing. So getting these high fidelity images for high glossy marketing images or for a catalog at the very end. So it's not only experiencing it in real time, it's also about the giving it the last touch and produce some images that are so realistic that you can't say, is it real or is it a 3D image? 4 years ago, we had the request from our customers that they want to bring in user interfaces into VRED. Until then, everything was very static. So customers brought in their Photoshop graphics or some JPEGs, sometimes some movies to display or to communicate the different variations of car HMIs to their board members or to their management. And they had that request that they actually want to experience and use it and show which consequences a click on a button has in the rest of the car. So we were scanning the landscape a little bit. And this is how the HMI development process looks a little bit like. So from the very early ideas to a digital model, which maybe has some animations in it, to a first click dummy mock-up kind of thing, what you can try out in a seat bug, for example, until to the very end engineering. And we scanned that landscape, and you can see there are many tools from the very beginning, like Photoshop, to the more mock-up and engineering space, like Qt is. And VRED at this time is very strong in the car development process in that two early phases. So concept design and digital design model is where we're coming from. And we looked at that landscape and we came up with a simple approach to use. So we said, okay, HTML5 might be something interesting because it's a very generic format. There's a huge community out there. It's platform independent. And basically you can realize everything that is dynamic and animated and you can click on. And therefore we have implemented back then the Qt web engine to realize that, and Markus will tell you a little bit about what it is.
Okay, I will talk a little bit about the technical implementation. So as Pascal said, we are using Qt web engine to display interactive content. we can, inside of Thread, we can map the web engine to any texture we want, so use any texture channel. So you can have interactive content on any texture in your 3D scene. You can interact with it with the mouse or with keyboard. What we did is we put the web engine in a separate process. We call this the VRED Media Server. We did this because of performance reasons, because during implementation we found out that the Chromium render performance really went down when we were using this in VR. So we put this in a separate process. We are setting up communication between the between VRED and the media server through Qt remote objects, so we can start them, we can stop them, we can serialize our input events and send them to the media server. And this is how we are transferring the image to VRED. So we have the media server render the web content to a hidden window. Then we are using the Qt Quick OpenGL renderer for that. So then we are just looking for the OpenGL context and grab the entire browser window with GL read pixels, write this to a shared memory block, so that it can be accessed from both VRED and the media server. And then we inform VRED that the next image is ready, and VRED just copies it to a texture. This way we were able to achieve over 60 FPS with full HD textures. So.
Cool, thank you. So I'm really sorry that it's not working in full screen, but I'd like to show you the videos as well while we are talking. But what can we do? So, okay, that worked quite well for our customers and for us itself. And but this was not the end of the story, because in the beginning of the year, with the introduction of 5.12, Qt introduced that WebGL streaming. So, and they claimed that they are able to bring any UI. There are some limitations, but to bring any UI into the WebGL stream, so it can be displayed in an HTML5 canvas, while the core stays on your machine. So it's more streaming that into it. And this was actually the time where we came together and reached out to Sammy and to Brooke. So thanks for the introduction again. And we said, so come on, we could then bring your UIs in Thread as well. And this would allow us to go more into the engineering space. So where we are with our HTML5 approach, not that strong. And Qt said to us, so yeah, and we with our tools try to go more in the design space. And this was a perfect fit. So with the introduction of the Design Studio and the plugins for Photoshop or Sketch, there was a synergy. And we said, okay, let's try something together. Because, as Sammy explained it to us, there are tools that are made for designers like Qt Design Studio or Qt 3D Studio, so an environment a designer feels comfortable with. He can make his UIs to a certain point before he hands over the stuff to the engineer. And at that point, you are able to see, with that streaming approach, you are able to see your UIs in context with the 3D model at a point where the 3D model doesn't exist as a real prototype, so a virtual prototype. And you can play around with that stuff, and there's a lot of benefit for our customers in doing that, to experience something that isn't existing, so to save time and costs. So, and the idea is, I think that was explained already, so there are tools, you stream that into the WebGL, into a browser, and therefore you can stream it in Thread. And we actually proved that, because we said, so I have no idea about programming or scripting, but I have a designer background, and let's build something and let's see how far I can get with that. So we built that tiny little application in Qt Designer. And to be honest, after 1 week, I got the concept behind it and I can drag and drop the stuff in there. And then it needs some slight adjustments in QML if I need some super customization, but it's not that difficult to learn, to be honest. So we built a tiny little example, and if you run it, it plays in that QML player and it can actually do some interactions and it shows you a digital clock. And if you move the slider, here the color change. So, and I was able to do that without any help of programmers. And this is a perfect fit because also in Qt Designer, yeah, from here you are able with a side-by-side installation by creating a new run environment with that port, you can stream your UI into that port. And doing so, let's play that. I can have my 3D model next to it and simply stream the content from Design Studio into Thread. So 4 years ago, we have introduced that HTML5 approach and therefore a small tiny little module called Media Editor. And in there, I can simply type in my port or my URL where it's streamed to. And if I refresh and update that, I have that clock in a 3D environment, in a 3D space. And this is actually where, for me as a designer, starts now the interaction between my product I want to create and the UI interface I want to create. But then, of course, I want to have something else in the end. I want to have an application I can use maybe later on that device. And therefore, it needs a developer who can actually make something out of my design without starting from scratch again to build something we can later then use.
We already saw the little clock application in the 3D scene, we are streaming the display using the WebGL plugin introduced in Qt 5.12. But we want to take it a bit further here, so we want to have bidirectional communication between our demo app and VRED. What Pascal didn't show, I think, is that we have a plugin in VRED written in Qt for Python where we can actually create configurations of different Qt Quick apps so that you have, if you have multiple displays in your scene, you can easily assign ports and map them to textures and just manage them easily. We can also not only control them with the mouse, we can use this in VR, so you can touch those displays and we automatically generate mouse events if you touch this with your VR hand, which you can see outside in our demo booth. For this little demo, which we will continue in a moment, there are two communication channels we added to this demo. The lower dotted line is the communication between VRED and the demo app. There's actually a little Python script running inside VRED that uses the Python socket library and just sends some plain text commands to the demo app. For the demo app, there is a little C++ class implementing a QTCP server, listening to incoming connections. And when it recognizes a command, it just maps them to a Q property so that it is available then in QML, and you can connect to it and react in your Qt Quick app. The arrow on the top symbolizes the communication channel from the demo app back to VRED. For this, again, there is a small C++ class which has, we show this in a moment, it maps the color slider that Pascal already showed to VRED, because we can control the color of the environment lightning with that. So there is a C++ class with a color property. This color property, again, is exposed to QML. And every time the slider changes, this property is updated with a QColor instance. And yeah, we just take the RGB values of that on every change, compose a Python string, open a QTCP socket, connect to Fred's HTTP server. There's an internal web server where you have access to Fred's internal Python API and also to any user scripts that you have currently running in your scene. And for this demo, there is a little Python function that just accepts RGB values and then sets the lightning color.
So, yeah, I will show that live too. So at that point where I hand over my gave my project to my developer, I don't need Qt Design Studio anymore because Marcus built that standalone executable for me, which looks like this. So this is actually the application running, does basically the same, but has that communication port in it. And the original idea of, the original designer's idea was to have not only a clock, that a clock is also a lamp I can turn on and turn off, and I can change with that U slider the mood of the sleeping room at night. So what we did is a tiny little Python plugin where you can load your executable that then runs in the background. Very simple. You open it, and then you simply start it or open it, and then you can start it in the background. And that tiny little plugin we did can handle multiple Qt applications at the same time. So if I have an environment where I have multiple screens and every application is a single standalone executable, I can manage that in here and assign it to different displays in my virtual reality scene. And when I open it, the scene the next time, I have that configuration stored in here. So it opens it, it starts it now in the background, so I can also connect with my web browser to it, but I can also simply copy that URL that was generated with that 9000 port to Fred, and then I use again that media editor I showed you earlier and use that port in here as well. So, and now I have loaded the application Marcus wrote for me. So I don't have a Qt Design Studio running in the background. And this actually now works. So I can press that button here and it executes or drives that animation I have created. And I also can change that U slider, which is changing the light or the light hue value of my lamp. And this is actually what we try to achieve and where I'm as a designer very happy with, because I can now play with my designs and even with the application that will probably be later installed on the device, I can experience that in VR already. And as Marcus said, that works in VR as well. So if the scene gets a little bit more complex, like a real car, for example, then this is a real benefit for our customers and for designers who can experience HMIs, cluster displays, before the product exists. So if you haven't seen it, there's a demo outside where you can try it out in a car in virtual reality. If that was interesting for you or for your process or for your company, feel free to reach out to us, talk with us directly, or join us on one of these social channels if you want to know more about Autodesk VRED. So that's it from our side. Thanks for your attention.
Yes, thank you. That was pretty amazing. So now we have a couple of minutes for questions, if there are any. So, questions? Yeah.
Hi. I tried the demo. Do you maybe work with the hardware provider to, like, instead of using those joysticks, make something more natural? I mean, like, because, and the point of this is to virtual experience, the, let's say the cockpit of the car, interact with the UI and stuff. So, I mean, it's so better to have as close as possible the real feeling, not the, the joystick.
Yeah, sure. So every head-mounted display comes with these controllers, and they have different weird ones. So the the HTC, for example, which is more joystick, big like this. So it's you are right. So the interaction feels not really natural. There, you can use other approaches, like for example, Leap Motion, which has a finger tracking. There are even devices now. The new Oculus, for example, has the has an inbuilt hand tracking system, which recognizes that. You can use that as well. We are not supporting that out of the box yet, but you can do your own implementation of that. Fred has an open Python API, and then you can use that SDK and map that to, I don't know, simple hand model transformations. Other concepts, we have seen customers that build a kind of hybrid approach. They have a seat bug, a real one, and there is a display in it which recognizes the touches, but they're using virtual reality to exchange the content on the on that touch display. So the touch is just for giving a force feedback the moment you, you touch it. But the interaction that is triggered is a generic one, so there is nothing on that display because the HMI is in the head-mounted display. So there are other approaches too. Yeah. The force feedback, there are also other concepts out in the market, like Manus VR, which is a cloth that has a kind of exoskeleton inside, preventing you from making a fist or things like that. Yeah, that's as well. But that's also the more expensive solution. It really depends on how much you want to get or how close you want to get to the to that reality in virtual, right?
Yes, any more questions? All right, if not, then thank you again. I think now there's lunchtime, and there will be more graphics talk in this same room after lunch. So hopefully I see some of you again.
Thank you.